morning, everybody. My name is Asel Sartbaeva, and the X I will talk today about is making vaccines thermally stable at room temperatures. Before I go into talking about this problem, I just wanted to tell you in a very short story how I came up with this idea. So less than 3 years ago, after the birth of my daughter, I took her to the doctor to be vaccinated. And what I observed was that the vaccines had to be taken out of the fridge and administered pretty much immediately. And that made me thinking, what if I can use an inorganic material or my knowledge of inorganic material to try and stabilize the vaccines so that they will be stable at room temperatures? And that's how it all started. So let me tell you more about the problem. More than 2.5 million children under 5 die every year from vaccine-preventable diseases. These are diseases like pneumonia, rotavirus, tetanus, whooping cough. All of these diseases have vaccines. So these deaths could have been prevented if children received life-saving vaccines. The biggest problem why they don't receive these vaccines is our reliance on cold chain. So what is cold chain? When vaccines are produced by manufacturers, they immediately have to be stored. They immediately have to be stored in refrigerators. They're then transported around in the vans using refrigerators, and a lot of them have to be flown to different countries. And again, we have to use refrigerators here. Usually when they arrive to the country of destination, they're stored in the warehouses before being transported around, and again, they have to be stored in refrigerators. Finally, they arrive to the local hospitals where they have to be refrigerated up until the point they can be administered to the patients. Almost at the end of this. So if there is a problem with electricity, for example, we get vaccines wasted on the way. And up to this point, we waste about 5% of the vaccines. But in the last leg, we waste today about 40% of the vaccines. And until recently, this waste was even 80%. So why do we waste so much? Well, here is why. In the last leg of their journey, they're transported on camel backs, on horsebacks, on the bicycles, or by people walking around with cold boxes. And a lot of these vaccines don't actually survive even for more than an hour above 20 degrees centigrade. So you can see where the waste is coming from. Apart from waste, there is a big cost associated with cold chain. So UNICEF is the biggest distributor of vaccines worldwide. And what they say is that at the moment they're paying about 95% of the cost of the vaccinating programs into cold chain and transport. And they estimate that they spend more than $300 million on cold chain only. And this number is increasing every year. So this is the reason why vaccines transport is so hard. They have to be stored precisely between 2 to 8 degrees centigrade. Above or below those temperatures, the proteins in the vaccines denature, and they lose their potency, and people cannot be vaccinated with them. So today, only two diseases worldwide have been eliminated, smallpox and rinderpest. Interestingly, both of these diseases have naturally heat-resistant vaccines. Another disease which is almost eliminated today is polio. Injectable polio vaccine is not heat-stable at room temperature. But there is another formulation. There is also an orally delivered polio vaccine, and that vaccine is heat-stable. So that's helping us to try and eliminate this disease worldwide at the moment. So let us look at the vaccines. Apart from DNA-based vaccines, most vaccines are based in their structure on proteins. So if we look here, we have viruses, virus-like particles, and protein complexes. The vaccines have secondary structure, which consists of alpha helices and beta sheets. They have a tertiary structure where the protein is folded neatly into a specific shape. And they also have a quaternary structure where we have several proteins folded together. And we can see that on the left-hand, on the right-hand side on the virus. Proteins denature by losing their quaternary, tertiary, or secondary structure. So here is a schematic movie showing you protein denaturation. So what's happening here is that this protein is losing its secondary and tertiary structure. It's basically unfolding. This is analogous to boiling an egg. When we boil an egg, proteins in an egg unfold and tangle up. And we all know it's impossible to unboil an egg. So to combat this, I thought maybe we can use an inorganic material, silicon, to try and cage the vaccines to prevent them from denaturation. There are lots of reasons why I chose silica, but let me just tell you several of them. So firstly, silica is a non-toxic material. It's very abundant, it's very cheap, it's something what sand is made of, and we have a lot of sand on Earth. I also take inspiration here from nature. There are tiny creatures, marine diatoms, which live in rivers and oceans. And what they do is they make silica coating around their bodies. And this coating preserves them from the environment. There also have been mummies of Urumqi, which have been preserved for thousands of years in the dryness of sand. So all of this tells us that there is a possibility of using silica to help us here with this problem. So what we're trying to do at the moment is to see if we can use very simple chemistry, sol-gel chemistry, to grow protective coating around each specific virus or a protein within the vaccines. And we think that this coating can preserve the vaccines from denaturation, so it can help us to store the vaccines without the fridges. So what's happening here is that this silica shell, it's physically preventing the vaccine from unfolding and from losing its secondary or tertiary structure, so from losing its shape. Once the vaccine has been stored like this, it can be obviously transported around, and then it can be administered to the patients. And here we thought about different scenarios of how we can administer the vaccines. In the first one, we can administer both silica and the vaccine orally. So this is very analogous to the existing polio oral vaccine. So here, the vaccine and silica would pass through the stomach, and stomach acids would attack silica, weaken it, and the vaccine will be released in the bowel. In the second route, we're thinking about injecting the vaccines. So we want to break down the silica just before the vaccine is injected. So here we are looking at several very easy chemical methods to break down the silica shell and then inject the vaccine. The third route, and this is the more speculative route, is directly injecting silica with the vaccine into the bloodstream or intramuscularly into the patients. And this is the route which we have not explored so far, but we are not ruling it out. Apart from the vaccines, there are a lot of other biological substances which require cold chain. These are antibodies, insulin, different drugs, antibiotics, antivenom drugs. So all of these substances may... For all of the substances, we might be able to use a similar method to preserve them and store them without cold chain. So, just to wrap it up, we don't really need, we have a lot of really good vaccines already, so we don't really need to change them and to come up with new formulations. What I'm proposing here is just to add the silica right at the very beginning when we make the vaccines. And this will allow us basically to store and transport the vaccines without requiring refrigeration. So potentially this can save a lot of energy, it can save a lot of money, and most importantly, it can save millions of lives. Thank you for your attention.